Welcome to Jung Tuition. I am Jung. Let's continue discussing basic issues in physics and their implications in other fields. Today, I'm going to draw your attention to the incompleteness of the Planck law for thermal radiation. Of course, it is relevant to the fields I had independently investigated in the past few years. I am sure you'll be delighted to find new perspectives in dealing with some taken-for-granted claims and hypotheses in physics. One's life would be very boring if one merely worshipped a particular few heroes by their names. Here, I would sincerely thank those who make their donation to this channel. So, are you ready? Let's go and have fun. Prior to Max Planck's breakthrough work in 1901, it had been known that the intensity of thermal radiation could be well described by Stefan Boltzmann's law, namely the intensity I equal to sigma, the constant, times the temperature in Kelvin to the power of 4. It is ridiculously simple, as the intensity in watt per meter square is only depends on nothing but the emission temperature of the object, irrespective of any microscopical structure and mechanism involved during the thermal radiation. In many a textbook, the temperature here is defined as the surface temperature of the thermal radiation emitter. In the real world, however, we know that the so-called surface temperature can hardly be determined accurately. Consider the flame of a candle, for example. The temperature varies noticeably from the center of the flame to its edge. Similarly, this happens to the sun and other stars. In particular, the vertical temperature profiles of Earth are by no means uniform. From very center at the core, if there's any, to the so-called top of the atmosphere, which can hardly be defined. Besides, more than one different definition for the temperature have been introduced in the US atmospheric standard. Perhaps that's why nobody could explain the frequency or wavelength distribution of the experimentally observed thermal radiation towards the high frequency or short wavelength regions, known as ultraviolet catastrophe, before Max Planck. Do you know how Planck made his empirical formula work? Here is a simplified description you cannot find elsewhere. So please like, subscribe, and make a comment. Following others, Planck used charged simple harmonic oscillator to describe the thermal radiation or electromagnetic waves in a confined, empty cubic space surrounded by condensed matter at a thermal equilibrium temperature T. This is exactly how standing waves are formulated in a rectangular microwave cavity for the electron spin resonance spectrometer, which is my research field. In this way, the energy density can be written as the following: U equal to 48 mu squared divided by c cubic, multiply the mean value of the energy. E bar is the mean value of energy at different modes possible. The essential assumption Planck made is to express of the energy of different modes as a multiple of its quarter, namely E sub n equal to n h mu, where n is an integer, and h is a Planck constant, and mu is a frequency of the thermal radiation or electromagnetic wave. Unlike others, I have used both Einstein distribution in quantum statistics. In this way, we can quickly obtain the mathematical expression for the mean value of energy of different modes determined by different lots of the standing waves. Finally, the Planck law for the thermal radiation, known as Planck function, is derived, as shown here. Apparently, throughout the durations, no microscopic structures of the thermal radiation source were considered explicitly by Max Planck. Apart from his reluctant assumption for discrete thermal radiation of energy. What does that mean? It means that the Planck law can be applied for any materials as long as they can form an enclosed cavity, such as this brass cavity used for X-band EPR spectrometer. However, things can become absurd when the Planck law for thermal radiation is applied for the standard model of the sun, which had been speculated as a gaseous plasma at a very high temperature. In recent years, this basic issue has been discussed in depth by Dr. Pierre-Marie Hôpital, I hope my pronunciation is correct, at his YouTube channel called Sky Scholar. By the way, he's a good friend of Professor Bernina at Ohio State University, who has been a great editor for many specialist books on magnetic resonance. I also know Professor Bernina, although I didn't meet Dr. Hôpital. Meanwhile, Dr. Hôpital has also shown Kirchhoff's law for thermal radiation is wrong, or at most, meaningless. I know some retired researchers have taken both Planck's law and Kirchhoff's law for granted, as if they were the basic laws in physics. From now on, care must be taken based on my preliminary research. Since 1860, thermal radiation by gases such as water vapor has become known. But can it be justified to apply the Planck law to describe the infrared radiation by the atmosphere? If so, how can one work out the standing waves that Planck was obliged to use to derive his formula? I will stop here and let you think and come up with some answers by yourself, because you can become an independent researcher too. In passing, as an independent researcher, I will never become a member of any groups. I only care the search for the truth in my life independently. Thank you for watching. Thank you for making a comments, and thank you for donation. And a very happy new year to my dear friends. See you next time.